For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I'm well. How are you?
Good. Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed again.
That's right, because you've been up longer this time than normally.
Yes.
Well, we're still working on exploring the attributes or characteristics of what it means to be a priest under the new covenant. And I felt God lead me to this particular passage in James chapter 4, which is, resist the devil and he will flee from you. But as I studied it, God started impressing on me that there's two components. It's not just resist, which is what we talked last time, a warrior, and we've talked about binding, but also the word that goes with it, which is humble. How's that? You don't normally put those two in the same mouthful, but let's pray. Father, help us today as we explore and are taught by your word and by your spirit. Give us ears to hear what you're saying to us today, and help us to not only learn something in our minds, but let it transform us as we mix it with faith and we take it for ourselves and we believe it and we, as I think it was Ezekiel, he was given a scroll and he ate it. And I pray that as we're given these words today, we'll eat them and make them a part of ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So a really edifying study this morning as I was going through these passages, which I'm quite familiar with in the English, but as I'm doing my dives, I'm finding out there's more to it. So instead of just reading that one passage, I'm going to read James 4, 6 through 8. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit or subject yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and he will come close to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. So this is really, this one message, it seems to me, just jumped out at me this morning. This whole idea that God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. So it's our job, therefore, to humble ourselves in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt us. Now, this is James speaking. Listen to what Paul says. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's the second chapter, verses 5 through 11. So I was blessed by that. Here's James on one hand. We don't know how much interaction he had with Paul. We read about in Acts when Paul came back to the church and James was, it looks like, presiding over the apostles. But James is saying the same thing that Paul is saying, a little bit different. And we're going to see later that Peter says something similar. But let's go to the source. This is what Jesus himself says. When you are invited by someone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in a place of honor, lest someone more distinguished than you be invited by him, And he who invited you both will come and say to you, give your place to this person. And then you will begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit in the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at table with you. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. There it is, right from Jesus himself. He also taught four chapters later in Luke 18 about the tax collector and the sinner standing in front of the wall. The tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. It's almost word for word what he said in the 14th chapter. So I started digging a little bit, and I looked up the word for humble. Now, there's two words. There's the one that's the adjective, humble, lowly, meek. And then there's a verb, which means, we just read there, humble yourselves. So in the Strong Greek, it's number 5013, is tapenao. It means to be humble, lowly, or meek. Jesus himself was described in Matthew 11:29. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and tapenao. I am lowly, humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Mary, in her magnificent, I say magnificent because it's called the Magnificat, her testimony, her proclamation, you might say, of the truth, in Luke 1:52 says, he has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. Tapenao. Now, not only did James and Paul make this connection, building on what Jesus had taught them, but also Peter. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 5 through 9. Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. There it is. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. And now we're going into the next part of our thought for today. Not only are we to humble ourselves, but we are also to resist. The rest of this passage says, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded. Be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith. So that word resist, fascinating word. It's a combination of two words. It's anastemi, which has got the ana and the histemi. So the anti, which is just shortened to ant in this antistemi, is opposite or against. And histemi is to stand. So what it properly means is to take a complete stand against. As Bible Hub says, a 180-degree contrary position. I like that. To establish one's position publicly by conspicuously holding one's ground or refusing to be moved. So anastemi is stand against, oppose, resist. Thucydides, which I had to look up on how to pronounce. In Greek, he said this word was used as a military term in classical Greek, and it meant to strongly resist an opponent, to take a firm stand against. Isn't that good? So this word only appears a couple times in the Bible. I think three times, antistemi, and one of them we read in 1 Peter 5, and then you've got James. Go back and read that again. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. When we take a strong stand, when we stand in opposition, when we resist him firm in our faith, he will flee. Absolute promise. Now, I took the word apart, as I said, anti was against, but histemi, which means to stand, has its own wonderful references. Here's one that has it several times. Ephesians 6. I know you're not surprised that we went to Ephesians 6. You're probably already there on your computer. 11 through 14. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. There it is. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand. There's the antistamy. And having done all, to stand firm. That's histemi. Stand, therefore. So there you have it. You get that word histemi appearing as part of antistemi and by itself three times in that one passage. So I like to think of when I'm standing firm, when I'm standing therefore, when I'm standing against, that I'm not just standing, I'm leaning forward. I am. It's a resistant standing. I'm not just sitting there twiddling my thumbs and checking my phone for messages. I am there purposeful. I wish you could see my face now. It's purposeful. I feel like I'm like one of those kings after Gideon killed those big kings, you might say, and he wanted to teach them all something. And he said, here, put your feet on their neck. And so these people came over and they put their feet on the neck of these highly exalted kings of the day. And that's what we want to do. We want to have that position of we are still resisting you, even when we're not resisting you, even when we're not praying and fighting, we're still standing and we're leaning forward.
It kind of reminds me of Little League baseball when the coach would say, get in the ready position. You're not just standing there, you know, milling about the infield. You like kind of squat your knees down just a little bit and get ready for like a line drive to be hit your way, you know?
There you go. I like that. Yeah.
Or like a warrior with the sword drawn and ready to go. Probably more appropriate.
You're not sitting there polishing your weapons and stuff. You're ready to go. See, now you got my mind. I'm at the, what's that one with Russell Crowe? Gladiator.
Yes, exactly.
You know, if you're out there like and you're ready to go, you got your armor on, you got your sword, and you know something's coming out of that gate, and you're ready for them because you're standing. That's good. Okay, so have you ever sung the song Soldiers of Christ Arise?
Yes, been a long time.
Well, I tweaked it a little bit this morning. I worked on it a little bit, but we have a men's group that meets at our church on Thursday nights, and I've introduced hymns. So we sing what I would call masculine militant hymns. So one of them, Soldiers of Christ Arise, or Rise Up, O Men of God, these kind of hymns. And they like it. And they miss it when I'm not there because apparently they don't sing them. But when I'm not there, someone needs to step up. So anyway, Soldiers of Christ Arise. So I was reading through the history of this hymn. It's in our hymn book. And as I was reading through the history, my friend who did the research explained what panoply is. Do you know that phrase? One of the verses says, stand then in his great might with all his strength endued, and take to arm you for the flight the panoply of God. So do you have a panoply with you when you're going to battle?
I know the word, but I don't remember what it means.
Exactly. Most of us don't. So my researcher explained it's from the Latin or something. Anyway, so I went into the Greek, and it turns out it comes from Greek, Strong's Greek 3833. It's panoplia from pas, which is every, and hoplon, weapon. It puts them together. So properly, what it means is a complete set of defensive and offensive armor. I'm reading now from what it says in the Strong's. Everything needed to wage successful warfare. The full resources the Lord gives to the believer. Isn't that good?
That's awesome.
And it's used twice in that passage I just read. In Ephesians chapter 6, it says, put on the whole armor of God. And the Greek word is panoplion. And then it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, panoplion. There it is. It's only used three times, I think, in the New Testament. So isn't that rich?
Yeah.
So now, shall I sing this for us? I'm just going to read the verses as I tweak them and put them together. Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on, strong in the strength which God supplies through his eternal Son. Strong in the Lord of hosts and in his mighty power, who in the strength of Jesus trusts is more than conqueror. Leave no unguarded place, no weakness of the soul. Take every virtue, every grace, and fortify the whole. That having all things done and all your conflicts past, you may overcome through Christ alone and stand entire at last. Stand then in his great might, with all his strength endued, and take to arm you for the fight, the panoply of God. From strength to strength go on, wrestle and fight and pray, tread all the powers of darkness down, and win the well-fought day. Isn't that good?
Amen.
So we do it. We put on the armor. We fight. We're poised for battle, but we do it humbly. I think that's what God's trying to get across to us today, because as priests, we don't want to be proud, even though it's a high calling. He's chosen us for this incredible calling to be a priest unto God, a priest warring with him and worshiping him and giving thanks to him and drawing near to him and seeking him, all we've been talking about. But we do it humbly. We humble ourselves. And at the proper time, God will do the exalting. Our job is to do the humbling. So we humble ourselves, and at the same time, we stand firm, and we resist, and we believe that God is greater than our enemy, and we continue to fight the good fight of the faith. And regardless of the outcome, if we're the last one on the little dome of a battlefield and everything around us is against us, we're still standing there and our sword is in our hand and we're still trusting in Jesus and we're going to persist and fight and go down. If we do go down, we're going to go down fighting. Amen.
Amen.
By the way, when I say resist, I know I've done this before on this podcast. I don't say I resist the devil. I say, I resist the devil. It puts some teeth into it because I'm fighting. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I don't go out there and use a cream puff to battle. I got a sword in my hand, sweating, bloodied perhaps, but I'm going to resist him, and I'm going to do that. And this is part of my prayer when I'm praying for my family. Things are going crazy. You can just tell things are out of sync and everybody's just a little off. And sometimes the best thing I can do as a dad, go into my room, kneel down by the bed and resist the devil in Jesus' name and believe that he'll flee from our home. Sometimes I feel it myself. I just feel attacked and there's no reason why I should feel the way I do or sense the things that I'm sensing. So resist the devil. So we practice on the little things and we apply them to the big things. Amen.
Yeah. I can't remember the verse, but there's somewhere where it describes Jesus' prayers as being like loud cries.
Okay. This is definitely a God's stuff right here. You ready?
Yes.
No, I just researched this for my own benefit because part of my, you might say my discipline, I put together these prayer sheets and what caught my attention a few days ago, and I looked at it and it said, it starts off with, on this one particular sheet where Jesus is the high priest, that's the whole focus of the page. And the Spirit just attracted my attention to the first verse I had. On the last and great day of the feast, Jesus stood up and cried out. if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. And I thought, I wonder what that Greek is for cried out. So I looked, and it's krazo, K-R-A-Z-O in English, but, you know, different in Greek. It means to cry aloud, to scream, to cry out loudly with an urgent scream, using inarticulate shouts that express deep emotion. And this same word was used by those two blind men. Remember when they cried out for Jesus to heal them? It's also the word that describes Jesus when he was on the cross and he cried out with a great voice and yielded up his spirit. So there you go.
I had another thought earlier on the humility part. To me, humility and wisdom kind of go in this same category of just kind of assume you don't have them and you'll be better off. Like, if you assume you have wisdom, then you probably don't. If you assume you're humble, you're probably not, you know?
As I went through that the other day, I was studying other words that means to shout, to call aloud, to proclaim. John in the wilderness. There's another verse, though, that really encouraged me. It's Luke 18:7 that says, will not God give justice to his elect? That's us, who cry to him day and night, twice a day. So, yeah, I'm doing a lot of crying out to God. And may God hear our prayers and resist the devil so he flees, but also see that his kingdom comes and his will is done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Father, thank you for this wonderful exploration, you might say, into your inspired words. And Jesus himself was meek and humble of heart. But Jesus himself was also a great warrior. And in times of deepest distress, he cried out. So somehow we put all those together today. And as we started off with, we eat them, we make them a part of ourselves. We humble ourselves before you, recognizing that you alone are God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. But at the same time, there's an earnestness in us. There's a desire to see your kingdom come and your will be done and not the devil's will in this earth. So we resist them today in Jesus' name. But we don't do it in the strength of ourselves. We hide behind our big brother and we say, we resist the devil in Jesus' name. And we ask you to bring your kingdom on this earth in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve@spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.